Are North Carolina kids doing better in school? Well, new state data on public school performance and student achievement finds that across all subjects and grade levels, 58.8% of North Carolina students earned what's called grade level proficiency. 44.5% met the higher standard called career and college ready. That's just part of the results that give us a window into school and student achievement right now in North Carolina. Dr. Terry Stoops has been analyzing all of this data. He, of course, is the Vice President for Research, also the Director of Education Studies for the John Locke Foundation. Terry, welcome back.
Thank you.
First of all, give us a sense of what is measured when it comes to student achievement. I know you've been writing about the difference between proficiency and growth.
Proficiency measures how well a student knows the subject matter in a given year on a given test, and basically will tell you how many answers they got correctly on the state test. And they set certain proficiency levels, and the students, based on how many answers they get correctly, can reach those proficiency levels. Growth is a little different because that compares an individual student performance in the current year compared to how they performed on the tests the previous year. And basically what the state does is they have a certain projection they use to determine what a year's worth of growth is for that child, and their performance on the state test determines if they meet that growth standard. So those are the two primary ways we measure student achievement in North Carolina. There are other measures like graduation rates and other sorts of measures that we use, but those are the two primary ones.
What was your reaction to the latest data in terms of both proficiency and growth?
Well, not much is changing, especially in reading. A lot of people were focusing in on the reading scores, the reading proficiency scores, to see if we are starting to see some benefits to North Carolina's Read to Achieve program. And this is a program that provides resources for teachers in elementary schools to improve reading instruction, specifically in grades K through 3. And so the hope of many is that we would start to see some movement in test scores because of the incredible investment we've made in Read to Achieve, and unfortunately we're not seeing that. In math, it's a little tricky because there were some changes to the math test and the reporting standards used for math, so we really can't compare those to previous years. Math proficiency is hovering around the 59-60% range, so that certainly isn't something to write home about. We would hope that our math proficiency would be better, considering North Carolina traditionally has had very strong math instruction, has performed very well on national assessments of math. You would hope that that would be mirrored in some of the state tests that are administered every year.
We seem to be making progress in science.
Yeah, science is looking fantastic, where depending on the grade, between 7 and 8 out of 10 kids are proficient in science, and that number continues to increase. We administer two science tests in North Carolina, one in 5th grade and one in 8th grade, which is consistent with federal requirements. So those are the two tests that we really zero in on when we look at science proficiency, and students are doing very well in science. It's a real testament to the teachers that teach those subjects, that they're able to raise proficiency in 5th and 8th grade science.
I never did well in science, so I'm in awe of that data right there. So the new data that was released for the last school year also looked at school performance and gave schools a grade. What do we find there?
Well, we have a grading system in North Carolina that looks at the two factors mentioned earlier, proficiency and growth. 80% of their grade is based on proficiency and 20% is based on growth. And there's a lot of controversy about that. We're basically seeing what we would consider to be an even distribution of schools, of A and B schools compared to D and F schools. And most schools are in the middle, C's. You think of what a bell curve looks like. That's basically the distribution of school performance grades in North Carolina. And honestly, that's one of the reasons why legislators are hesitant to get rid of the system that we have right now for determining school performance grades, because because it seems to distribute school performance grades in a way that makes sense along that bell curve. If you make changes, we either get a lot of A schools or a lot of F schools. And so that's one of the reasons why there's such an imbalance in the percentages used to determine school performance grades.
If I'm a parent in North Carolina and I'm trying to figure out if my child is getting a, quote, good education or not, I've got my child's personal grades. But based on all of this data, the school letter grades and the proficiency and growth levels, does that give a parent a good sense of where their child is and whether or not they should be pleased with what's happening at their school?
It's a starting point. And I think that the grading system is so much much improved compared to what we had in the past, where we would label school of progress, school of distinction, basically labels that didn't have a whole lot of meaning for parents. Parents understand a school grade, but it should be understood that that's a grade for the entire school and may not reflect how their individual student is doing, how the grade that their student is in that school is doing, or how an individual teacher is educating the children in his or her class. So it's a good starting point. Parents should look to see what the grade is for their entire for the entire school, but there are online tools that they can use to go look at the test scores for their individual children. The state provides a tool for them to be able to do that online, or they can go into the school and look at those records for themselves. So it really is a starting point. It was always meant to just be a starting point. And many of the people that object to these school grades believe it to be something that many parents use, but aren't using in the proper way. I think most parents understand that it may not be representative of their child.
Terry, we know that in North Carolina, we're one of the leading states in terms of providing options to parents. Parents here are demanding more options for their kids. A lot of them are choosing traditional public school classrooms because that works for them. Other families are choosing public charter schools, virtual schools, home schools, etc. In this data, did we get a sense of how public charter schools are comparing to traditional district schools?
Sure. We start to get some clues about that. And if you look at just growth rates, you see that districts are outpacing charters as far as growth, and just very slightly. But charter schools, as far as school performance grades, are outpacing districts. There are more A and B charter schools than there are A and B district schools. On the other hand, you have more D and F charter schools compared to districts. So you have some charter schools that are really outstanding and they're outpacing a lot of the district schools. Then you have some that are falling behind, quite frankly. Of course, if those schools continue to fall behind, they'll be closed. And that's the real difference here, is those D and F schools in districts will remain open and in some cases receive more money to try to repair instruction that's obviously falling short of what it should be.